Welcome to worship this Reformation Sunday. The sanctuary is in red. Some of us are wearing red. Red signifies the Holy Spirit and our celebration of the Holy Spirit at the time of Martin Luther's 16th century church reforms of the theology of grace, worship practice, scripture in the common language, and so much more. I invite you to grab a Bible or download the online bulletin on Augustana's website so that you have available to you Romans chapter 3, verses 19 through 28, because that's what we'll be diving into during the sermon today. And also today we celebrate the confirmation students whose 3 years of study culminates in the affirmation of baptism. They pick up the promises that their parents made to them at baptism as they continue asking questions of faith as baptized people. And that was recorded prior to this, and so it will be included in our online worship today. A couple of another announcements as we begin. Thank you to one and all who are bringing cans of soup and beans and other things to our soup shelf at the entrance to this sanctuary. We always need more. The demand has gone up. People are hungry and they have found the soup shelf. We will be pulling it in during cold weather until we figure out how to keep a cupboard warm out there to continue its 24/7 availability to people. But in the meantime, if you could bring additional food after you grocery shop and bring cans only to protect that food from the wildlife, please, that would be great. Also, one more, next week is All Saints Sunday on November 1st, and we'll be having a special short prayer service in the Memorial Garden, so please be paying attention to your weekly emails so that you can make a reservation for that service as well. Now we open in prayer together with a prayer of the people, and when I say, Lord, in your mercy, you're invited to respond. Hear our prayer. Drawn together in the compassion and steadfast love of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Renew and inspire the church in the freedom of the gospel, O God. Where the church is in error, reform it. Where the church speaks your truth, strengthen it. Where the church is divided, unify it. Ignite in us the working of the Holy Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the climate changes, as mountains shake and the waters roar, may we care for this planet as a holy habitation for all living things. Sustain all peoples and lands recovering from natural disasters of any kind, and strengthen our resolve for sustainable practices and energy to heal our land. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of salvation, you promised to deliver us. Give those who are suffering a strong sense of your presence and love. Accompany those who are uncertain and raise the spirits of those who are despairing. We pray hope and healing for Betty, Robbie, Sue, Sandy, Liam, Willis, Marcy, and those we name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In love, we recall your holy ones who now live in your undying light. Bring consolation to the family and friends of Ms. Chris Bachman, Vivian Bankson, Norma Taylor, Terry Tessendorf, Nancy Vickman, and those we remember in our hearts. In our remembering, give us a foretaste of the feast to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We celebrate the youth affirming their baptisms in the rite of confirmation. May they be assured of your presence as they grow in faith throughout their lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. A covenant that they broke though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another, or say to each other, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more.
The second reading is from Romans chapter 3. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets, the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe. For there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by his blood, effective through faith. He did this to show his righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that he himself is righteous, and that he justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? By that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This is the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Oh, the places you'll go, or not go, depending on who else is there, whether or not masks are required, and how much or how little you need to see people. As those things get figured out, place takes on new meaning in our lives. Our favorite places usually qualify as favorites because they're fun or beautiful or peaceful or sacred, or we find our favorite people there. These days, the places we go are often necessary and cannot be avoided, or meaningful, and we bend to accommodate them. Adjustments have also been made to meaningful places, like the way we worshiped under a tent in the courtyard over the last few months. Last week, place was also shifted for our confirmation students who were affirming their baptismal promises in the Rite of Confirmation. Annually celebrated on Reformation Sunday, we held a brief ritual with the youth and their families and recorded it to be celebrated with all of us here in online worship. It was a unique confirmation, as the few of us who gathered together represented the fullness of the congregation in the sanctuary, our community's sacred place. Place is important to what Jesus is saying in the Gospel of John reading, as he says, "The Son has a place in the household forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." Jesus' place brings freedom that cannot be created on our own. This is good news if you don't like the new place in which you find yourself, feeling displaced by the pandemic. Jesus' freedom can also sound like good news if you've been displaced or excluded by other people for reasons like income, disability, skin color, or education level. The 16th century Reformation took place in complicated socio-political times that parallel our own. Martin Luther was not the first reformer of his day, but he was the first reformer to survive long enough to disrupt the systems of church and start applying pressure to both the Pope, who controlled the church, and the princes, who controlled the city-states of their time. While Luther condemned the institutional church for its extortion of the poor and manipulation of the faithful, he also challenged the princes against exploitation of the peasants. Luther and other Reformation preachers were adamant that princes and leaders address systemic issues. Luther wrote, "For so to help a man that he does not need to become a beggar is just as much of a good work and a virtue as to give alms to a man who has already become a beggar." Lutheranism has long since preached justice-oriented community engagement on behalf of our neighbors, alongside the grace of salvation by faith, apart from works. In fairness, though, this grace and justice preaching had its place long before Luther. In the Romans reading, check out verse 25. The execution of Jesus at the hands of the Romans gets flipped into the language of sacrifice. The first century listener would have heard that and said, "What?" Everybody knew that sacrifices offered to God meant specific animals killed in the temple by a priest. No one would have equated a Roman execution of a Galilean rabbi on a hill outside of town with sacrifice. More specifically, the Greek word hilasterion, translated here as sacrifice of atonement, is more accurately translated as mercy seat. The early listeners in Greek would have heard that the redemption in Christ Jesus was put forward by God as a mercy seat through faith in his blood. Now this is big, so hang in with me here. The mercy seat was known to be in the Holy of Holies in the Jewish temple, where the high priest entered only once a year to sprinkle blood over it on Yom Kippur for the atonement of all of Israel. This section of the Romans reading transforms the unholy place of the cross into the Holy of Holies, the center of God's reconciling grace, the place where the unholy, non-Jewish Gentiles are transformed into holy Christ believers and God's servants. These verses claim that God transforms the unholy place into a place of holy transformation, transforming the unholy into the holy. And put a placeholder there because we're going to come back to it. Another dilemma in the English is that the word for justice and righteousness in the Greek is the same word. It's one word that means justice and righteousness. First century listeners would have heard this word to simultaneously mean righteousness, right relationship with God, and justice, right relationship with one's neighbor. There was no choice needed to be made about meaning, like there is in English. The place of justice for our neighbor is the place of righteousness with God. There are many people who celebrate the Reformation solely as an event in history that revealed God's reconciling grace with each individual believer. What often gets missed is that it was simultaneously an event that turned the believer away from self toward neighbor. This reading from Romans is the perfect place to open up God's word in the fullness of the Reformation and to allow it to open us up as God's word finds a place in us. Grace was at the heart of the 16th century Reformation, and love of neighbor completed the freedom granted by Christ's grace. Luther also wrote, "Poverty, I say, is not to be recommended, chosen, or taught, for there is always enough of that by itself. As Jesus says in John, the poor you will always have with you, just as you will have all other evils. But constant care should be taken that since these evils are always in evidence, they are always opposed." I'm going to let you in on a well-kept secret. There's an election coming up. Democracy and voting would have been inconceivable to Luther and his peers, not to mention to our first century siblings in Christ. But they all would have understood justice and neighbor love as required by God. We've spent the whole last church year in the Gospel of Matthew, in which Jesus lifts up the vulnerable and oppressed as our faithful priority as faithful people. And just around the corner, coming up in Advent, we'll hear Mary sing about lifting up the lowly, filling the hungry, and sending the rich away empty. Voting is one more place to help our neighbor as we examine ballot issues, judges, and elected leaders. Remember to pray for yourself and each other as we vote. Remember also that the mercy seat of Christ dwells within you by the power of the Holy Spirit in your baptism. When we were baptized into Christ, we were baptized into his death, into the mercy seat of God. The unholy places in you are the very places that God redeems and makes holy for your sake in God's righteousness and for your neighbor's sake in God's justice. Today on Reformation Sunday, we celebrate that everyone has a place in the household because Christ is the mercy seat through which God redeems us and sends us in freedom to love and serve our neighbor. Thanks be to God, and amen.
Thank you. Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism and for these people, one with us in the body of Christ, who are making public affirmation of their baptism. I present these people who desire to make public affirmation of their baptism. Bryn Aristad, Anna Bjornebo, Emily Bjornebo, Anna Blanchard, Errol Owen Burr, Maren Y. Massey, Stuart Motes, Calvin Stone, Xander Johnson Story. Let us pray. Merciful God, we give thank you for these sisters and brothers whom you have made your own by water and the word and baptism. You have called them to yourself, enlightened them with the gifts of your Spirit, and nourished them in the community of faith. Uphold your servants in the gifts and promises of baptism, and unite the hearts of all whom you have brought to new birth. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen.
So I'd like to ask then, please, for the young people who are being confirmed, just the young people to stand, please. That's all of you. There you go. So you have made public profession of your faith. And so I ask you, do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? And we'll ask each of you, please, to answer individually, beginning with Bryn. Errol, yeah. There you go. Maren? Stuart, and then Calvin, and Xander.
People of God, do you promise to support these siblings in Christ and pray for them in their life in Christ? If so, answer by saying we do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
We do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give us new birth, cleansing us from sin and raise us to eternal life. Stir up in Bryn the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up in Anna the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Stir up in Emily the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up in Anna the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up in Errol the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up in Maren the gift of your Holy Spirit, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up and steward the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up in Calvin the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence both now and forever. Amen.
Stir up in Xander the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence both now and forever. Amen.
Let us rejoice with these sisters and brothers in Christ. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we will give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. And now receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Welcome you to Holy Communion on this Reformation Sunday. We celebrate an open table here at Augustana, so you are welcome to receive the gifts of Christ's body and blood today. You're welcome to use grape juice or wine and bread or a cracker, whatever you have available at your home as we celebrate this sacrament with Christ today. The Lord be with you. We lift up our hearts and give God our thanks and praise. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray together as Christ taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. For those celebrating with us today, I invite you to pause this video at this point and to receive Christ's body and blood in your household or alone, knowing that we join together in this meal as we are part of this worship service online together. And now we receive this blessing together. The God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus. The God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The God of all grace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.